Siesta Key Beach making headlines again. It recently was voted number one, but some local residents treated it like number two. We'll talk about the mess that was left on the sand and what could have been done to prevent it.
And what if you could be nicer to the people you work with? A local organization is making kindness contagious on the job. And we'll show you ways you can be kinder to your coworkers.
It's never too late to pick up a new hobby. We'll meet a Suncoast woman who put on her first dancing shoes at age 63, and now she's dancing all the way to a world championship competition in Argentina. All that and more right now on Suncoast View.
A nice way to kick off the show. Welcome to Suncoast View. That was Wendy Feinstein and Flavio Cattuara. Yes, kicking off our show with the Argentine tango.
That makes me mad. Wow. She's 63. She looks 33. Nobody should have legs like that at 63. Wow.
But that's why she's dancing.
She is actually 67, she says, but she started her dance journey at 63. We're
going
to learn a lot more about Wendy and her journey from one studio to a huge competition coming up.
I think she's lying about her age. She really is 33.
Well, she's not lying about her great talent, and we're going to see a little bit more dancing later on. But welcome to the show, Stephanie Gallart.
Thank you. It's great to be back.
Yes, and you've got your dancing shoes on as well.
I'm ready.
We're
going to
have a good time. Right. Stephanie's coming all the way over the bridge from St. Petersburg American Stage Theater Company. We're going to learn more about what's happening over the bridge later on in the show.
That is a long way. What, 23 miles?
It's such a beautiful drive. You know,
it's
a great way to start the day.
Yes, that's a nice way to think about it.
Yeah,
it is.
I've met so many people that are terrified of that bridge. And the Skyway Bridge, and I think it's beautiful.
Because it's always shaking.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, when you're on it, you don't.
No.
I mean, you don't. Yeah, I think from afar, it looks a little intimidating. But when you're on
it,
it's just gorgeous.
Going over it. It's so beautiful.
Yeah, it really is.
Every once in a while, my mind will look, though, and think, wow, there's a lot of water. If this bridge wasn't here, it'd be a long way till I got to land. But we are glad you made it.
I'm so glad I did, too. Thank you.
We're also happy that Chef JR made it from JR's Packing House Cafe. Welcome back. How are you, JR?
Very good. Good morning. We have all kinds of neat stuff. We're going to have Fiesta Shrimp. And some tomatoes, some avocados, and some plantains, and something low-calorie, high in protein for later on.
Wow. I'm liking that.
All right. Fiesta shrimp, a little diet food.
A little diet food, yes. We have black beans and tomatoes and all kinds of yummy stuff.
What didn't
some
you
roasted
bring?
Garlic.
the entire cafe is closed today.
So and plantains, too.
Well, wait till you try these. We're happy you're here. We're also happy to get into the kitchen with you later on. And we just want to say we're thrilled that you're back open after. I know it's been a few months, but we certainly don't want to take for granted the fact that you're back up and running.
This is one year.
Congratulations.
Wow.
We're happy. We're happy you're back. We're happy to join you later on. And Linda, we're happy you're back.
Oh, what a great day it was yesterday.
Yes. Linda rarely calls in or misses work. I don't think ever. But this was a wonderful reason. Tell us where you were yesterday.
I was at Leo's graduation. Leo is my six-year-old grandson, and he is going into first grade. He bridged. They call it bridging. He went over the bridge. Aww. That's my daughter, Kathy, his mom. And he is now going to be in first grade. You know, I was at a speech when I first started in television, and the person said, don't ever pass up the things that matter for the things that don't last. And I hope my job lasts a long, long time, but I do know that jobs don't last, but family does. Yeah. So always you have to put your family first.
Are you grandma or nana?
I'm grandmommy.
Grandmommy.
Yes, I'm very proud of that title. It's been the most fun title I've ever had.
Now, do your grandkids, do they see you on TV, and do they understand? You know, I remember as a kid thinking, like, you're on the box. and now you're here.
How are you in there?
I have had one say when I'm there and I'm on the box, how'd you get out of there? Look, Grandmommy, you're still in there. How did you get out? So they used to. Now it's like, change it to cartoons.
Oh, yeah,
they don't want to see you get over things so
exactly. Yes. Well, congratulations, Leo. We're excited for him. All right, it is time for our first hot topic, and it's a little bit of a tough one. Siesta Beach might have been voted the best American beach by Dr. Beach this year, but last weekend it was left looking its worst. A higher number of visitors this weekend led to more garbage than usual. We're talking overflowing trash bins, leftover food. The Herald Tribune reports literally hundreds of bags worth of trash were picked up from South Lido Beach and Ted Sperling Park, as extra staff and volunteers were required to help clean up. Now, was this just a lack of common courtesy from the beachgoers, or does it sound like maybe the beach wasn't really prepared for the number of people that were coming?
They know how many people are coming. They do it every year. Mm-hmm.
But this is a bigger problem, because this has happened almost every holiday, because there are no trash cans mm-hmm. but at the top of the beach. So if you don't have any resources for people to put it in, mm-hmm. right. they're going to leave it on the sand, because not everyone is going to take their trash back or lug it around and walk around looking for those bins.
Mm-hmm. That's an excellent point. So even if you were being conscientious, and let's say you have to hike a long way to your car or even take the bus, you can't take your garbage with you. And if there isn't a place to deposit
towels,
it.
So they mm-hmm. need to move them closer. Because, you know, I've been downtown after New Year's Eve when the whole town was full of hundreds of people, thousands of people. And by 9 o'clock in the morning, it is perfectly clean because the crews have been out there. So maybe we need to kick out some extra money and get some crews down on the beach mm-hmm. to clean it up quickly and move those trash down.
That's true, too.
Well, it's not a problem we just have here, though. Stephanie, have you seen this other places in St. Peter? I know you're from California.
Well, like Florida, California has miles and miles of beachfront. And I think it really varies a lot by community and mm-hmm. towns. And I think it goes to right what you're saying. It's really a lot of it, I think, is about resources, because if people have a place to deposit their trash, but what happens if they don't, then, and you start to see mess, then that kind of mm-hmm. exacerbates. Mm-hmm. People see, well, everyone else is doing it, and I think mm-hmm. it kind of just compounds itself. Yeah. But I think individual communities have to really kind of make it a priority to put the resources into keeping it.
Yeah. So do we.
And you know, the individuals.
What my mother would say was, pick up that trash. Were you raised in a barn?
That's true, too.
Yes. Well, I read that Pensacola actually had a similar problem, and, you know, not ironically, it was after Memorial Day every year. And this past year, they did an initiative where they gave beachgoers garbage bags as they came onto the beach, mm-hmm. which was almost, you know, it's in your hand, fill it up when you leave. Mm-hmm. And it did help.
There was a resident last year, and her name fails me now, but she started a bag initiative where she literally got the bags herself and started handing them out with volunteers. And it worked for one of the holidays, but, you know, this isn't something the resident should be doing. Mm-hmm. This is something that the county or the city, wherever the beach is that is part of the issue, mm-hmm. should be chipping in to do, because you can't, residents can start grassroots efforts, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. but really, is it a resident's responsibility? And if a resident has to take up the responsibility, and I know the issue from the past was, the county told her to stop because they said it wasn't her responsibility. She's like, well, I'm helping. And now here you have a situation again where the beach is back to what it was, and no one is doing anything to either move trash cans or get staff to clean it.
Yeah, and we've talked on this show quite a bit, and several of our guests have voiced support for the growth,
yeah.
right? But this is one of those cases where if I lived on Siesta Beach and people came and partied and left, I understand why they'd be upset
sure.
and
yeah.
don't want to see this kind of growth.
And people leaving the mess are not the ones who then are dealing with the aftermath mm-hmm. of it, because
exactly.
they're leaving and going
right,
back.
Right, it's like coming to your house, having a party, and then leaving right. your dishes. Well, speaking of food and dishes, many of us know how inconvenient food allergies can be when we're eating out in restaurants. But some people are getting frustrated with what they're calling food allergy fakers. A California chef recently spoke to OC Weekly about this growing trend of what they're calling allergy liars, saying it's like pulling the fire alarm in junior high. Eventually, people just stop paying attention to the allergies, and it could cause a real problem for people with real allergies, kind of like crying wolf. Mm-hmm. Some dieting websites are coming under fire for recommending that patrons say that they have a gluten allergy. For instance, if they want to avoid foods that go against their diet. All right, so be honest, has anyone here ever said they were allergic to something just to avoid having it served to them?
No.
Good
no,
for you.
We're very honest.
We also eat anything.
That's true.
I don't know if we're a good judge.
Well, I've been out a few places recently, and, you know, the gluten-free diet is mm-hmm. a huge fad right now. And I did ask for, I think, gluten-free pizza or something, and they said, is it a preference or an allergy? And I thought, well, that's a great question, because for me, it was just a preference. So you don't have to cook it in a separate kitchen.
The whole prep.
Mm-hmm. Because that is huge for a restaurant to have to do. So I get why they're upset.
A lot of time. My ex actually used to lie about, no, say stop lying. Because, you know, it makes you not pay attention anymore, like what the study was saying.
Mm-hmm.
And I would end up cooking it anyway. And that's how I knew he was lying.
Obviously, he wasn't allergic. He would have died long ago.
That's how I learned he was lying.
It reminds me of, there was a Sex and the City episode where Carrie says that she was allergic to parsley, and then after the waiter walks away, her date says, you're not allergic. She goes, well, if I say I don't like it, it always happens to end up on my plate.
Huh. That's what they say.
Yes.
No,
so
they don't want to go through the hassle of the confrontation of saying they don't like something.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you just say, oh, I'm allergic, and now you don't have to worry about people harassing you or eating it.
Right. You don't have to have that conversation.
But if it is just a preference, why shouldn't you just, you know, have that preference honored?
Mm-hmm.
Because maybe people are passive aggressive
and they don't want to just confront it and say, hey, I just don't like your food.
Have you ever tried to order, like, hold the cheese or something? At some delis, I'll say, hold the cheese. It's almost like my mother's, like, pressuring cheese on me. I'm like, do you have stock in the dairy market? All right, I'll eat the cheese. All right, well, are you a fun drunk? That's a question I never thought I'd ask on TV. Are you a sad drunk? Or maybe your friends might tell you you're an annoying drunk. Or are you the same kind of person that you are sober? Mm-hmm. A study by Clinical Psychology Science looks at alcohol's influence on our personality, and they concluded that we don't really change all that much. Rather, alcohol may intensify a particular personality trait that we already have. But the concept that we are different when we drink is largely something that we actually choose to believe. So do you think that people just use that as a cop-out?
I resent that.
Mm-hmm.
I cry when I drink. I am no fun. I'll be over in the corner with tears running down my face. If Bo Beth walked over, I'd say, oh, it's Bo Beth, I love you so much. And nobody wants to be around me. So I don't think I'm that way when I'm
sober. So that's why you don't drink a lot.
That's why I don't drink a lot. It's no fun. I just feel bad when I drink.
Oh. Well, I mean, is there affection that you have for your friends that maybe you don't show, and then it comes out when you drink?
Oh, no, the bad things I think about them come out, too.
Well, to say that a part of our personality is intensified, I mean, we all have kind of this whole range of things. So an angry drunk we all have some element of anger in us, and I'm just kind of curious about a little bit, you know, what the study really means.
Yeah. I think the funniest part is when you're the sober person in the group
and you see
people acting a little different, you're like, okay.
That's
hopefully
really
I do
are.
Not act like this when I'm drunk.
Yes, it's an interesting study to be the only person not drinking at times, because the world forgets that you are not drinking as well. Bartenders know everything.
Yeah,
well, does more daylight in the morning mean better school test scores for adolescent kids? A new study showed that kids in central time zones, where it gets lighter earlier, did better in math and reading than kids in eastern time zones. The study focused on the Florida panhandle, where both time zones exist. Experts say having tests an hour later than sunrise actually boosted test scores. And don't blame the kids. Sleep needs are driven by puberty, and older kids can't help not functioning well on darker mornings. So do you think there's something to this? I mean, testing a kid when they first get in the morning, and when maybe their brain and
they're
conscious
sleeping.
Thought isn't up.
Yeah.
They're still sleeping.
And anyone who's been the parent of a teenager can tell you that they're not at their best in the morning, and that's a real thing. So.
But you know what? I think you've got to learn to adjust to your environment.
Yes.
Your environment is not going to adjust to you. The sun's not going to come up when it's convenient.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to learn to adjust to what is.
I agree.
And you'll be better off all your life.
Yeah. Well, both of you have been parents. Have you, especially now as we're looking at summer and it's like it's staying light to like 8:30 here, do you have a hard time getting the kids to bed? Was that a problem?
I don't have, you know, as a grandmother, I don't have to put I play with them and give them popsicles. I don't put them to bed. You probably put yours to bed.
Well, mine's a grown-up now as well, so she goes to bed when she feels like it. But yeah. And I think it's a curious thing that we have, you know, really if you think about starting things early, that goes way back to like our agricultural days. And that's so why are we still kind of forcing ourselves to operate based on a clock that is not necessarily as relevant to our lifestyles
that
anymore?
That doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Because kids are out of school in the summer.
And I know Stephanie,
they had to work on the farm.
I know Stephanie said this yesterday to me. She said now they're out of school, that literally their bedtime is 11 or midnight, and she has to go to bed to be up early.
Yeah.
So she's like not liking it.
Yeah.
But try explaining to a kid. I remember arguing with my parents, like, but it's still light out. I don't have to go to bed yet. But yeah. I mean, I actually am still that way.
It just pushes everything back a couple hours.
Mm-hmm. Well, less sleep.
I can still go to sleep. I proved that last night by going to bed early.
Well, Grandmommy lets everybody stay up, so we're going to spend the night at Linda's house. All right, well, speaking of sun and weather, it's our time for our happy hour forecast. And when we come back, we're going to get some good news from Goodwill.
Just Bob Harrigan on this first day of the 2017 hurricane season. Nothing out there right now, but we will be talking about a little system that may be developing down the road here in just a little bit. But right now, we have inland showers and storms developing east of I-75. And for the most part, near Parrish, there's been a one or two lightning strikes there. We'll keep an eye on those cells. They've been generally moving off to the north, not moving very fast, though. And you can see another lightning strike there just into eastern portions of Manatee County at this point. As far as the latest goes, we are anticipating not much going on here. We will see a few showers inland through this evening. A couple of those will eventually work their way back toward the coast. You can see that just to the northwest of Parrish, some rainfall there, not all that heavy and not moving all that much. Showers are right along Moccasinwala Road, and then down south just to the east of Venice into southeastern portions of Manatee County, our lone shower there. Well, much more of the forecast coming up at 5. See you then.
There is nothing better than a random act of kindness. And Goodwill Minnesota is several months into their community-wide campaign to encourage more kindness here on the Suncoast. And to find out how it's going, we asked Veronica Brandon Miller, the vice president of Goodwill Minnesota, and Jacqueline Moore, the former mayor of Northport, to join us. All right, so Jacqueline, remind me about this community kindness program. What is it?
Kindness Community, it creates social change by making kindness a way of life, and it's great to be back. I was here with you all last October, and on December 1st, a lot had happened between October and December, connected with Veronica from Minnesota Goodwill, Goodwill Minnesota. I keep putting that in the wrong order. I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
And we are
alumni. We do too.
We are alumni of the Gulf Coast Leadership Institute. So last October, we said, how can we get together and make kindness more of a focus in our region? And since then, so much has happened. And we're going to talk, I think, more details. But Kindness Community has a Facebook page, for example. In Northport, we launched a Kindness Is video campaign just May 1st. And there were over 800,000 views of over 150
wow.
videos.
Oh, yeah.
So it is so resonant with people. It's really startling and amazing in a good way.
Well, speaking of amazing, can you guys tell me about what are some of the things people are doing and, you know, how they're showing it, their kindness to others?
So just as Jacqueline said, it's encouraging social change. So now people are really thinking about what they're doing. And like we talked about, people are actually sharing through video. It could be something simple as, you know, going in to work and saying, you know, good morning and how was your day? Simple things that we take for granted, but now it's changing an entire social change.
And we spend so much time at work. When you think about how many hours, you know, 8 hours a day, that's you know, as much as we should be sleeping, we spend with the people we work with.
Right.
And how are some of the people in Northport getting involved in this? Because I know this is kind of where the beginnings happen.
It is where the beginning happened because I lived there and because at the time I was caught on fire at the mayor's conference last June, almost a year ago when I had that experience in Indianapolis. And I knew that I was supposed to focus on kindness. So fast forward and here we are. And so the commission in the great city of Northport have officially adopted a resolution making Northport a kindness community.
Oh.
And then in May, a proclamation around this Kindness Is video campaign. And then last week, Sarasota County, I think you have a picture of that at some point. So we'll move on to that. But Northport is all over it, and we have people everywhere, every day, sending us notes saying, here's what I've done today that's kind, or I've noticed people being kinder, to the point you were making, Veronica. It's really, social change happens in at least four stages. There's a lot of models for change, but awareness is step one.
Wow.
And when we look at the world and how challenging it is and can be, a way that we can bridge the differences. It's easy to be kind when we agree on things, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
We mere mortals have no issue with that. It's when we don't agree, when we see things differently. So I've given each of you a kindness stone.
Oh, thank you.
And I encourage you to carry that around with you. And I wish I had an extra to give you to give to someone. But to me, it's symbolic that no matter what happens, there's a gap between what happens and what we choose to do, how we choose to respond. And that is how the social change will happen. Where we take that moment, we take a breath, and we realize kindness is always a choice. The Dalai Lama says, we have to agree on nothing. and we can still be kind. I challenge all of us to keep that in mind.
Well, speaking about the choice, Veronica, Goodwill got involved in this program. Tell me a little about how you guys are encouraging kindness in the workplace.
Well, since the launch of the Kindness Community, so many people have come to us and said, hey, this is what we're doing. This is what, you know, other people can do. And it was an epiphany. We turned around and said, do you know what? Let's do a speaker series of kindness at work, because there are exceptional companies out there. Cool Today is going to be speaking about what they do, because they're trying to encourage others to take suit and create a more kinder workplace and social community. So we have Remax Alliance Group. Oh, fabulous things they're doing. PGT, Adams and Reese, Publix, Culver's.
This is great, because a lot of these companies might be even like manufacturing, and you think, well, how will they connect to kindness? So it's so nice to see anybody can get involved in this.
Anyone can be kind.
And
we want best practices. So again, you know, this is a whole change in our community that Jacqueline Moore has created.
And you know, to your point earlier, you said that, you know, we work so much, and sometimes we aren't as nice to our coworkers. Right. So this is a good encouragement. Mm. I like the idea.
Yeah. Don't throw the stone at
us. Don't force my kindness on you.
It will make us think. Be kind.
All right, well, for more information about the Kindness Community, you can actually go to Goodwill's website and get all of the details about that. And next, Stephanie's going to share what's going on at American Stage Theater. We'll be right back.
Because my parents told me I have to be responsible.
Because my first coach told me, you can do this.
Because my boss showed me how to do a good job.
Because my teacher helped me see the choices.
I'm swimming faster than I ever dreamed.
I am a valuable employee.
I discovered that I could work as an artist.
I will be whatever I want to be.
Youth with disabilities should grow up expecting to work and succeed. For more information, visit whatcanyoudocampaign.org.
Attention, Americans eligible for Medicare. Are you getting all the benefits you're entitled to? Did you know there may be money available to lower your medical prescription costs? Call Health Markets and we'll tell you if you qualify.
Hi, I'm Dr. Martin Jeetze. It's a new Medicare year. That means more changes and more confusion. The key question is, what can you do now to ensure you get the care you need in the coming year?
Call Health Markets today. You may qualify to save money on prescriptions. We'll help you find plans that may cost less, cover more, and could even lower your prescription costs to increase your savings. We help you find all the benefits you're entitled to, and we do it at no cost.
Make sure you have what you need to get the care that's right for you.
Find out if you qualify to receive extra help with your prescriptions. Call the number on the screen now. Representatives are standing by.
Are you Goodwill?
Yes, because when I donate
or shop at Goodwill,
I am creating a job.
I am Goodwill, yeah, yeah.
I am a veteran. My victory was finding the strength to be a champion.
My victory is having a job I can be proud of.
At DAV, we help veterans get the benefits they've earned.
My victory was finishing my education.
My victory was getting help to put our lives back together.
DAV provides veterans with a lifetime of support.
My victory is being there for my family.
Help us support more victories for veterans. Go to DAV.org.
ABC 7's Primetime is brought to you by Gattle Automotive.
American Stage Theater Company in St. Petersburg is delving into a deep and very timely topic in their latest play. That's the impact of American capitalism in the Middle East. Our guest host today, Stephanie Gillard, is the producing artistic director and can tell us a little bit more about The Invisible Hand. Stephanie, a lot of us went up and saw Hairspray in the Park.
Yes.
Like unadulterated fun.
Absolutely.
Quite a change for this next show. It just, how does that fit into the entire season?
Well, our season theme is In Search of America, and lots of different styles of plays on our main stage, but all of them kind of looking at what America is right now, who we are, who we're becoming, and just providing an opportunity for some really engaging stories, but some great conversation around those stories too. And Ayad Akhtar is one of the most exciting American playwrights right now. Many people in Sarasota may remember his work from Disgraced, which Oslo produced recently, and Disgraced won the Pulitzer and every other award out there. Mm-hmm. And The Invisible Hand is his follow-up play, and he writes a lot about he's an American, a Pakistani-born, a Pakistani-American, and he writes a lot about geopolitical issues, but he writes with such a riveting story style. And The Invisible Hand is essentially about an American banker who is taken captive by a group of, not yet terrorists, but a group that could potentially evolve into a terrorist group. And they are seeking ransom to support their cause and their efforts. And of course, the U.S. does not negotiate with any group that resembles a terrorist group. And so the banker is left to his own devices to try and solve how to raise his own ransom. And he essentially kind of befriends his captors to help them learn to play the stock market as a means of raising his ransom. Wow. And it really plays like an exciting political thriller, but underneath that are a lot of interesting questions about complicity in from both the U.S. and the Middle East in kind of what goes on, how money kind of feeds the machine that is the war machine in the Middle East.
Wow. I mean, it's no denying that at this moment there's tension about, the Middle East here. Are you nervous as an artistic director putting this play into the season?
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
on the shoulder.
Yes. This kind of, it's always a way, when you look at theater, is a way to get topics that are very controversial so it can come to the light, we can have discussions mm-hmm. about it. So
club discussions, yes.
I always say, I have two goals with every play that I select. One is to tell a really good story, and the other is to open discussion and dialogue and get us kind of looking at things with a little bit more of an open mind, mm-hmm. and particularly around challenging issues. That's where we kind of need those opportunities the most. And I certainly, when I selected the play, I didn't know exactly what climate we would be in right now, because the play, I select plays a good year or more out. So it is a delicate thing right now. But I think that the story is so well told, and it's so balanced. It's not anti anybody. Mm-hmm. Everyone kind of gets their due in terms of, how we all play a role and the role of greed. And ultimately, it's a really good story. So I think that's the thing that people will come away with, and for those who want to engage in it in more of the kind of intellectual part of it, there's that opportunity for them as well. But it's just a great thriller. So
it sounds like a great show, and it's a premiere, right?
It's the Florida premiere. We're really excited to have the Florida premiere. It opens tomorrow night.
Wonderful.
Yeah, back in rehearsal this afternoon.
If you want to check out The Invisible Hand at American Stage, you can get tickets and information at their website, americanstage.org. Next, it is time to tango, and we're going to learn that it is never too late.
Love that.
Credit card debt can ruin your life. If you owe $10,000 and minimum payments are siphoning away your paycheck each month, you can get debt-free in less time than you think.
I've paid $800 a month for the past 3 years and haven't changed the balance on my credit card.
Get Debt-Free Now has a program to reduce your debt, stop the harassing phone calls, avoid financial ruin, and settle for less than you owe.
I feel like a huge weight has been lifted off my shoulders.
You're pre-approved for our special hardship program if you owe $10,000 or more. Upon payment of your new lower balance, your debt will finally shrink until you are debt-free.
My family no longer has 30 years of payments ahead of us at 20% interest.
There's no fees until you see results. So call now, make one monthly program payment, and free up your cash. Resolve your debt.
Call 800-628-1251. 800-628-1251.
When it comes to drinking, what do you think moderation is? The U.S. Dietary Guidelines define moderation as up to one drink a day for women and up to two drinks a day for men. So what's a drink? The guidelines say a drink equals 12 ounces of beer, 5 ounces of wine, or a cocktail with 1.5 ounces of distilled spirits. Each contains the same amount of alcohol. Like to learn more? Visit drinkinmoderation.org.
I witnessed him have two heart attacks in ICU. He went through seizures.
We'd much rather have Aaron like this than dead. A lot of parents don't have that luxury.
He can't talk. He can't walk. This is a condition Aaron will live with for the rest of his life because he abused prescription pills.
Mind your meds. Learn more from the Partnership for Drug-Free Kids.
We've all heard how military veterans adjusting to the civilian world may have certain issues.
30. 78.
If only everyone had this issue, no matter what challenge they face, Easter Seals is here for America's veterans.
A promise was made, a promise that hit the beaches of Normandy, a vow that captured Iwo Jima, a contract that weathered Tet, a pledge that stormed the desert in Iraq, an IOU that braved IEDs in Kandahar. A promise was made to America's veterans. DAV fights to keep that promise so all veterans and their families get the benefits and support they earned. For help, visit DAV.org.
Welcome back to Suncoast View. If you're just joining us, we have Chef JR from JR's Packing House in the kitchen. JR, you don't just have great food, you have great music. Tell us about something that's coming up later on.
We're doing, since this is the anniversary of last June, we're having a music event on June 25th, and we're going to have 8 bands. We're going to have 4 inside and 4 outside, because now we have an outside that we didn't have before last June. And so it's going to be a fun event. We have bands, we have live music, obviously. We're gonna have a Cuban buffet inside, some hot dogs, some burgers and Cubans and wings inside. Wow. And maybe even a playhouse or a bounce house or whatever they call that.
It's a celebration of the reopening, huh?
Yes, and so it actually falls on the anniversary more or less.
That's wonderful. Wow. Yes. Well, we were sad that you had the fire last year, but we're very happy to hear that you have built something better out of it. So you can find out more at Packing House Cafe. We'll be joining you in the kitchen a little later on. But from live music to live dancing, Linda, take it away.
Well, sometimes later in life, you find something new that really interests and excites you. For one Suncoast woman, it was dancing the tango. Even though Wendy Feinstein didn't start dancing until she was 63 years old, she is now headed to a world championship competition in Argentina. We are excited to have you with us today, Wendy. Wow, I still can't believe you're 63.
I'm 67.
Oh, I hate it. You look so good. So how did you happen to start dancing at 63?
It's such a great story. My husband and I were, believe it or not, on a hiking trip in Patagonia. And the last 3 days of the trip, my husband took me to one of the most beautiful tango shows in Argentina. I'd never even heard of Argentine tango in Buenos Aires. And I cried through the entire show. It just plucked me right out of that audience. And as we were leaving the show, I said to my husband, in my next life, I want to come back a tango dancer. And my husband said, why do you have to wait till your next life? And we went back to Argentina and stayed for about 8 days, and I started my first lessons there, which I believe this is a video of those lessons.
Oh my goodness.
My very first lesson at the age of 63 in Buenos Aires. And I have been dancing pretty much every day since that time.
Wow. So yeah. You really, really love it.
I am absolutely in love with it, addicted. It is the most fun I have ever had in my life, and by far the hardest thing I've ever done. And as I said, I was climbing mountains.
Well, how do you feel like when you see where you were and where you are now?
That's how you judge yourself. That's a great question, because you can't ever judge yourself as a dancer by where you would like to be. Mm-hmm. You have to judge yourself by where you started. Mm-hmm. And compared to where I started, I just hope I live long enough to get where I want to be. I'm very, very pleased. I'm very pleased. I've danced with some of the most wonderful teachers available. So.
Oh, tell us about these guys.
Yeah, I'm very, very fortunate.
So you don't have just one partner.
I did. For a very long time, I danced with a gentleman here in Sarasota who taught me how to dance. His name is Luis Pena, and he's at Sarah Dance Center. Mm-hmm. And he was my dance teacher for pretty much the first 4 years. And now I'm dancing with Argentinians that come passing through, and I travel to Buenos Aires every year, at least once a year, hopefully more. And I'm dancing with some of the greatest Argentine tango dancers in the world.
Oh, my goodness.
I have one of them with me today.
That Wendy is legendary in the community because in the Can Dance, the Community AIDS Network does their annual Can Dance. She's the example they always give of you may grow to love it and go on. And now, you know, you're at the top of your game.
So yeah, they have been so kind to me, Community AIDS Network. They invited me to do Can Dance in 2013. I had been dancing for 2 weeks.
Oh, wow. How did you do?
And I won.
Oh,
I won.
Yes.
And they invited me back the second year in 2014, which is pretty much unheard of. You never get to come back. You get to do it once. And the second time I came back, I was just entertainment. I wasn't competing. Oh. I just got to be the entertainment. So,
what's been the hardest part of this thing for you?
Oh, there's so many hard parts.
He's like, the stats. Yeah.
I guess the hardest part for me is the character. The character of Argentine tango. I've always been very athletic, very strong, you know, into fitness. And I've always thought of myself as kind of jockey. Mm-hmm. And that's not what you want to be when you're an Argentine tango dancer. It's a very passionate, very sensual dance, and
you have to bring out
that
sexy
character, and you can't be acting. You have to find it from somewhere within you for it to be real, for it to you know, be real. And that's been the hardest part for me. But I got it.
You can tell you got it.
You got invited to one of the world championships.
Yes. Well, that's because of wonderful Flavio, who's here with me today. You know, you can go to the world championship as an amateur if you want, with a partner. But to be invited by a gentleman who is acclaimed in the tango world in Buenos Aires, to be invited to be his partner in the world championship, when this man could have invited anybody in the world.
Oh, that's a testament to how great
this man.
You are.
Introduce it. He's going to come out and dance for us. Introduce us to him.
There, are you ready for me to
introduce? I'm ready.
Okay,
I'm
going to introduce you now to two of the tango greats visiting here from Buenos Aires. They're at the Sarah Dance Center giving lessons and workshops. This is Gladys Barrero and Flavio Cattuaro. And Cattuaro, who I will be dancing with in the World Championships. And they're gonna perform for you guys right now.
Okay, take
Feast
it away.
Feast your eyes on this.
Back the championship. I don't know how you could lose with that guy. Thank you so much, and we'll be back with some life-saving moves of our own.
ABC 7, your official Florida lottery station for the Suncoast.
If you've ever had a bad night's sleep, call and price the new Kraft Medic Legacy. It has so much more than other adjustables and still costs up to 50% less. Featuring a rising adjustable pillow rest to support your head, neck, and shoulders, bedside power plugs, under bed night lights, and more. So call and price one today for less, up to 50% less than Tempur-Pedic Sleep Number and other adjustables.
You get so much more and it still costs less. You gotta see how little they cost.
Call 1-800-774-8103. That's 1-800-774-8103. Call now.
From our studios on Florida's Suncoast, this is an ABC 7 News Update.
Hello, I'm Scott Dennis. Here's what we're working on now for 5 o'clock. It's the first day of June and the first day of hurricane season. We'll let you know what you need to do to be prepared for the season. And a highly contagious dog flu has hit Florida for the first time. The warning signs pet owners should look out for. Let's get a check on our weather now with Chief Meteorologist Bob Harrigan. Bob?
On this first day of hurricane season, there's nothing out there right now, but we are watching an area that has the potential down the road. We'll talk more about that coming up at 5. You can see some showers and storms developing, most of it inland as it has been over the past several days. It's looking good right now near the coast. The storms haven't been all that intense as they make their way off to the north right now. And they haven't been sticking around all that long either. We had some rain near Parrish just about an hour ago. That has now moved on, and we have another shower developing to the southeast of Parrish. And not much in Bradenton or Palmetto. Everything's quiet there. More in the forecast.
ABC 7, your Suncoast News. We're here for you weeknights at 5.
That is a pretty good breakfast. You're not even eating.
Not hungry.
No? Why not? What's up?
Kath and I knew that Jenny'd been partying a bit. Found out she tried heroin.
Most people don't know what to say about drugs, but we do. Visit us at drugfree.org.
This is an important medical announcement. Bard IVC filters have been linked to punctured veins and problems with migration. Anyone who's received a Bard IVC filter must receive medical monitoring and may be entitled to substantial compensation. If you have the Bard Recovery G2 or G2 Express filter, you are in a class of patients who should be compensated for some expenses. Call now for a free assessment of your case and potential money damages. This call is confidential. There's no cost and you may be eligible. Juries have awarded millions of dollars to people who should have been warned about the risks of the Bard IVC filters. Call the IVC filter hotline if you or a loved one has received an IVC filter and experienced a vein puncture or required medical monitoring. You must call now.
Call 800-329-3089. 800-329-3089.
ABC 7's Primetime is brought to you by Gattle Automotive.
And welcome back. Today is not a day probably very many people recognize, but it's a very important one. It's National Heimlich Maneuver Day. And according to the Red Cross, choking causes over 3,000 deaths per year. And knowing how to do the Heimlich may help save someone's life. And here to give us a lesson is Erin McCoy, the trauma intervention nurse from Sarasota Memorial Hospital. All right, so Erin, you know, when you're talking about Heimlich and choking, how severe and important is this?
Well, I mean, it's as simple as your ABCs. Your airway is most important. So if you can't, you know, air to pass in the airway, you can't breathe, you know, and then that could even lead to a cardiopulmonary arrest. So your airway is very important. So the Heimlich is a basic, simple maneuver that, truthfully, everybody should know how to do. And most everyone has either seen or heard of someone that's had it done to them.
So it's interesting. I'm sorry. It seems like CPR is always, you know, you always learn, you should learn how to do CPR. You should know, you know, the staying alive and everything. Mm-hmm. But the Heimlich almost seems like the forgotten stepchild, if you will. Of, you know, there's not a lot of education.
Not a lot of people talk about it.
Correct. You know, it's very basic, but I think it's so simple that people tend to ignore that. And look at the community we live in, a lot of elderly, a lot of people that may have had stroke or some swallowing problems, a lot of children here on vacation and so forth. A lot of people go out to eat in this community. I think it's very important to know this.
Oh, well, you mentioned the importance. What about the timing and choking? Is that important to recognize? And
absolutely.
Okay.
There's certain things you might want to look for on an individual. Obviously, you know, you might hear some outward sounds, some coughing, some stridor, which is some abnormal noises in the airway. That aside, the universal sign of choking, you know, if a person's coughing and so forth and they're able to move some air, you may not need to intervene at that point. You know, you can actually do more cause than harm. I know JR over there probably has some great examples he's had to have in his restaurant. But, you know, if somebody's coughing and you can hear air moving or they're able to be verbal, don't go up and pound on their back or start doing the Heimlich maneuver on them, because you actually can do more harm than good.
Oh,
so it's important if, you know, they have that universal sign they're choking.
Well,
and
we
they're showing
eat a lot
more distress
on this show, and we eat very quickly.
So we need to know.
So it's important for some of us to learn.
You know, and so we'll go through some of that, you know, as far as how to do that in an
adult.
Well,
can you give us a lesson right now?
Okay.
Oh, good.
Who's going to be the volunteer here?
I volunteer. Okay. This looks like fun.
All right. So...
He has to put his arms
So Linda, I'm going to go up to Linda and say, Linda, are you choking? And if she's not making any noises and she's looking a little more distressful, then I'm going to let her know I'm going to go up behind her, because you don't want to just run up to somebody and put my arms around her, you know.
That's okay.
So I'm going to go and I'm going to put like the C of my hand on her belly button.
Okay.
I'm going to rotate that in. Okay. And my thumb is kind of right here underneath her xiphoid, right on the upper part of her abdomen underneath her chest. I'm going to go around with my other hand. I'm going to go in and up, and I'm going to do it very sharply. I'm not going to hurt her by doing this, but I'm going to go very sharply.
And if she was choking, it would have worked.
Everything would have come out.
In and sharply. And if she would go, say, unconscious or whatever, you're going to go down to the floor and you're going to continue to do it on the floor, and then you may have to move on your CPR, you know, if she starts losing a pulse or whatever.
Okay.
So,
Linda, let's try it. See if you learned anything.
I saw what he was doing.
Okay.
Okay, Bobette. He said, put your hand at the belly button, roll it up, put your other hand on. Are you ready?
Yep. Boom.
See, her mouth popped open.
In and up.
And you just keep.
Okay.
And roll it up.
Cook. Here we go.
On the floor.
Okay. So you may
and
have
so
to do it on the floor.
So if you went down to the floor, and I don't know if you guys want to get on the floor, but you may have to be over the person standing over their torso.
And then push.
And put their hands on their upper abdomen and be pushing up on the floor.
Well, there's a lot of force that's being done with this. Could you hurt a baby if you were to do this?
Babies are a little bit different. Children, we tend to do the same.
Typically,
it actually might be easier. We can do it either way. Uh-huh. It might be easier if you take a knee or you're standing up with the baby. But on the baby, like a year or less, so if the baby's choking, okay, one thing they say they can do is you can lay them on a flat surface. And you can do it this way, and you can do the sharp back blows
on the back.
You're going to deliver five between the shoulder blades. Okay, you're going to support the baby. You're going to bring them over. I'm going to look in their mouth. If I see anything visual or easy, I'm going to grab it. I'm not going to do a blind sweep because their airways are a little bit different, you and I. But we're not. You could actually cause more harm by pushing that into their airway.
Oh.
If I don't see it, they still appear to be choking. I'm going to take the baby over.
One more time.
Okay. Do the back blow, I had it out of sync here, but I'm gonna take the baby over on their back, don't see anything, and then between the nipple line, I'm gonna give
five
compressions, okay? Look, don't see anything, and then you're gonna repeat the same process.
Wow.
That's also important. I mean, as men, I mean, it's a little bit easier to hold the baby like this, okay, in your arm, but have their head downhill a little bit.
This is just a very important thing, especially because not just babies, but adults can always be in a situation where they can choke. So it's happy to know that we can, you know, help if we take a lesson in this. All right, well, if you guys want to get more information about this, you want to go to Sarasota Memorial Hospital's website, and they'll have all the details of how you can get a lesson. And next, Golden Girls is coming back, but it's in an unusual place. We'll tell you where.
I knew I could get myself out of this. I just needed some hope and some help.
I took the first step to recovery when I made the call.
Since 2014, Addiction Hope and Helpline has answered calls for recovery and treatment 24/7, 365 days a year. If you're depressed, drinking, using drugs, or taking pills, call now and talk to someone who cares.
I had problems just getting to sleep, drinking and using pills every night.
I feel like I'm losing control. I'm afraid I'll lose my job or even my family.
Most insurance covers substance abuse. You can get back on track. Call now for hope and help with proven gentle recovery programs.
I never thought that I could be somebody who didn't drink and use drugs.
I have something to hold on to for strength. I'm in recovery, getting the help I need.
Call 800-622-1941. 800-622-1941.
There was this big bruise on my friend's face. I didn't want to see it. I didn't want to think her own nephew could have hit her.
I didn't want to see it. My mother's bank account was emptied, and her caregiver had taken control of it.
I didn't want to see it. My father's refrigerator, there was hardly anything in it. That's unusual for him.
It's tough to see that a senior citizen is being abused, physically, emotionally, sexually, or financially. Elder abuse is a crime.
So see the signs. Stop the crimes.
I am the resident district manager on the FAU campus for Chartwell. Whenever I see Haley, I do not see a person with a disability. I see a person with extraordinary abilities. Haley is always smiling. She's always on time. She gives fantastic customer service and is always focused on any job that she's given.
Hi, this is Dan Marino. When your business recruits people with disabilities, everybody wins. To find out how, go to disabilitieswork.employflorida.com.
I'm calling in regards about my mother, and I'm here, and I just want to thank you because it saved my mother's life yesterday. And I'd like to know the names of the people that came in and saved her so I could call and thank them. And she's doing fine. It's a wonderful thing. Thank you.
When you fall and cannot get up, an accident can turn into a tragedy. But with Life Alert, one touch of a button can get you help fast. Life Alert saves a person from a catastrophe every 10 minutes.
Life Alert is a lifesaver. If it weren't for Life Alert, I wouldn't be sitting here today.
For a free Life Alert brochure, call 1-800-962-4112. That's 1-800-962-4112. Call now, 1-800-962-4112. For a free brochure, call 1-800-962-4112.
Well, as summer comes, it's a great time to play board games, but there's a new board game out that I want to tell you about. We all know the game Clue, right? Well, what if the options were it was Blanche on the lanai with the cheesecake? That is the case with this new edition. It's the Golden Girls edition of Clue.
Oh, I love that.
It sounds hysterical. This is just being released now. You can actually pre-order it. And it won't come out until later this month, or actually early July. But it does have all your favorite characters: Blanche, Dorothy, Rose, Sophia, Stan, the ex-husband, and it takes the game of Clue and it turns it into Golden Girls.
This is like the game you made up, remember?
Yes.
I love it. You should have been.
Well, except they're getting the money. But actually, you will have a chance to catch me involved in Golden Girls. I'll actually be at American Stage this month. There is two nights only on Mondays. It is a reading of Golden Girls. Notice the Z, Golden Girls Live. That's because all four of the Golden Girls are being played by men.
Oh, that's so funny.
Yes, it's some of the extra programming at American Stage, which they do throughout their season, cabarets, fundraisers. This is a two-night only reading, and it is all for Suncoast AIDS Theater Project.
Who are you?
I'm Rose.
You're Rose.
Yeah, I know. We all have a little Blanche and Rose in us, but yes. So it'll be a lot of fun, AmericanStage.org. But first, we're going to be heading into the kitchen. We're going to join JR from JR's Old Packing House Cafe.
The official Suncoast Storm Team at ABC 7. We're here for you.
Ever since I can remember, I've been intrigued by industrial design and the optimization.
Wait, that's passion? Ever since I can remember, my passion has been industrial design. We need 3D printers for Miss Adams' engineering program so that we are ready to solve 21st century challenges.
Impressive. Think It Up is a new initiative to support student-powered, teacher-led learning projects. Students and teachers, how can you spark great learning experiences in your classroom today? Think It Up.
From our studios on Florida's Suncoast, this is an ABC 7 News Update.
Hello, I'm Haley Wilkes. Here's what we're working on for 5 o'clock. 48 tons of trash scattered across Suncoast beaches. What some residents are doing now to make sure this litter problem doesn't happen again. And now taking a quick look at Suncoast Traffic Watch, drivers are seeing some delays north and southbound on US 41 near Fruitville Road. Now, let's head over to Bob.
Haley, the first day of hurricane season, and we have a tropical storm, and it looks like it may be a player down the road. This is in the Pacific, however. But it is moving off to the northeast, and some models are hinting at a possible tropical low moving into the Gulf of Mexico. So we'll have to keep an eye on that. We'll have an update coming up at 5. Right now, just a lot of tropical moisture around, creating some showers well inland, away from the coast. Not much going on there, as it has been all week long. I'll let you know if that'll be changing as we head into the weekend. And our rain chances will be increasing next week. Details on that coming up at 5. See you then.
Check out mysuncoast.com/dining, your guide to the foodie lifestyle.
This is an important medical announcement. Xarelto and Pradaxa have been linked to uncontrollable bleeding and even death. If you've been prescribed one of these drugs and have experienced these dangerous side effects, you may be entitled to substantial compensation. Studies show that Pradaxa can cause more heart attacks than warfarin, and other countries have already issued safety warnings against this drug. Call now for a free assessment of your case and potential money damages. The call is confidential. There's no cost, and you may be eligible. Juries have awarded millions of dollars to Pradaxa victims, and thousands of Xarelto victims are filing their legal cases. Call the Drug Watch Hotline. If you or a loved one used Xarelto or Pradaxa and experienced uncontrollable bleeding, brain hemorrhage, or even death, you must call now.
Call 800-793-6055. 800-793-6055.
The kitchen is where life happens. Minnesota Flooring now offers a wide variety of beautiful quality craft-made cabinetry to make sure the heart of your home reflects your style. Visit us today at our new kitchen and bath cabinetry locations.
This is your brain. This is drugs. This is your brain on drugs. Any questions?
I have questions.
Prescription drugs aren't as bad as street drugs, right?
Weed's legal, isn't it?
Drinking is worse than smoking weed.
Isn't it?
Why
is heroin so addictive?
Molly just makes you feel happy.
I have questions.
Mom?
Dad, did you ever try drugs?
They're going to ask. Be ready. Go to drugfree.org. A message from Partnership for Drug Free Kids.
My name is Haley. I have Fragile X syndrome. I work with Chartwell's at Einstein's at FAU. I like being up front and interacting with students. The students are very nice and very hungry. Having a job is a big ticket for independence.
Hi, this is Dan Marino. When your business recruits people with disabilities, everybody wins. To find out how, go to abilitieswork.employflorida.com.
The official Suncoast Storm Team at ABC7. We're here for you.
Coming up Friday on Suncoast View, Troy's Tropics is here with plants that can handle our current drought and the long summer that's on its way. We'll watch a talented Suncoast contemporary artist create hand-painted original pop art live in our studio, plus pampering products for Father's Day and spice and tea exchange in the kitchen.
Welcome back. We're here with Chef JR from JR's Old Packing House Cafe, and you have some of my favorite ingredients in here. What are we making today?
Today we're making fiesta shrimp, so we're going to add some shrimp on here. And it worked well, yes.
Yeah. Ready to go. Yes.
Yeah. Hot and ready to go. And you're going to add the roasted garlic.
Roasted garlic.
That's the one right there. Perfect. Start off with that one. Yes.
A lot of garlic.
Okay, that's good. Yeah, that's good. That's good. It's roasted, so it's not going to be as pungent.
Don't talk to anyone for the rest of the day.
JR, that was just oil in the pan to start.
Just a little bit of olive oil in the pan. That's going to cook down. Because we're using roasted garlic, you don't have to really worry about that so much, and the shrimp cooks fast anyway. Next, she's going to add some roasted corn, please.
Ooh. A lot of roasted.
We're not going to add the jalapenos, which is this one, because unless you really want to.
Let's do it.
Well, then add it, yes.
Garlic and pepper. How about
yes.
There we go.
And a little bit of red onion cilantro.
Now, when you say a little.
Yeah, all of it, yes, that's perfect. And then this is the seasoning stuff. So if you can throw a little bit of that in there.
That's the magic sauce right there.
Yeah, that's a secret blend of salt, pepper, a little bit of garlic powder, a little bit of onion, and some cumin. And let's put some wine in there because I know you guys don't drink, so I'm going to pour the wine in the sauce. And then after all that cooks down for a little bit, we're going to add some nice diced tomatoes, some fresh diced tomatoes right there.
Here we go.
And
there
you go.
You want all these in there?
Yeah, okay, fine.
All right.
Yeah.
Why not? That's what they're for.
More is more.
Yes. More is more. And they're going to cook down. And then we can serve this. It's a beautiful dish because you can serve it gluten-free without the shell, obviously, the lettuce. Or you can do it over the rice.
Okay.
Or you can make tacos with it. And it's a nice, fun dish for the summer. Easy to make. And
very light if you don't add too much. You can even eat it like this.
You can eat it like this. So the roasted corn, you just take the corn from the farmer's market. Salted, blah, 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 roasted on the grill, and it's yummy.
Would you do some of this lime over the
Yeah, at the end, we're going to garnish with the lime. And I used Roma tomatoes today because they were beautiful today. I went over to Detwalla's yesterday, and I got the corn. And
how long does it take for the shrimp to cook?
pretty much as soon as you turn them over, the shrimp cook pretty fast. You'll see them brown and they'll tighten up a little bit. Mm-hmm. That's pretty much.
And JR, I see that Linda's got an avocado over there.
Oh, we're going to garnish it later with the avocados, yes.
This is the topping.
This is the topping.
Great. Well, yes. Let's get her cutting that up now.
Actually, it's already cut up because I
Linda, you're fast.
Yes, and then she's going to put it right here.
He has to cut it up. Okay.
Something like that. This makes nice little cubes already ready to go.
Nice. Oh. So
yeah. See how pretty?
Make your nice little cubes before you do
it. Yeah.
And it's already really beautiful.
And you don't have to use a cutting board then.
I like that.
Just don't cut through the skin, obviously, but
don't.
It's your hand on the other side.
You thought I couldn't do it wrong.
Oh, I'm sure. And we got some limes and put some limes on there. We got lots
just
of limes.
Leave it on
yes.
there, all over. Okay.
Oh yes.
Yeah.
Quite lovely. And the more lime, the better it is.
Yeah. Nice. Oh, I like this meal because it seems like you can do it in like 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Very quick.
Now, JR, as you're plating up, let's take another little tour of some of the other items that you have. I see across the front you have plantains.
Plantains because the ladies here like sweet things.
Yes.
And then over there I made...
Well, let's go next door. There's
the taco salad.
Taco salad.
We have taco salad on Tuesdays. It's quite yummy.
Oh.
Black beans. We have a tomato paste thing. We have the Cuban sandwiches
Your
here.
Your grilled Cuban sandwiches are fantastic. And you mentioned a
those are low calorie, high in protein. Well, they're guava filled pastries with cream cheese.
Nice.
Quite right, yummy.
Everyone try.
All right, well, as you plate up, Beth and I are going to have dessert first. But we'll start saying our goodbyes. Stephanie, thank you so much for crossing
thank
over
you.
The bridge. You can
thank
check
you.
Out
I'm
the
great.
Invisible
awesome
Hand
the
this month at American Stage. Nice. We're going to pig out with JR, but you take some time, enjoy the Suncoast View.